In the previous videos, we learned functors are like containers for types. We learned that functors provide us with a map function to transform the type they hold. But what if our structure holds two or more types? Can we have a mechanism to transform those types to new ones similar to map function in functor? In this video, we will learn about bifunctors and how they make this possible. Let's start with the function isEmail that receives a string and returns a boolean telling us if the input string is a valid email address or not. In the functor video, we learned that we can lift our function to an option context. We do that by calling map of option on our function. Option is a type constructor that wraps one type. But what happens if our type constructor wraps two types? One example of such a type constructor, as we've seen before, is either. We learned that either is functor. We just need to fix its first type parameter. And by doing that, we can define a map function to lift our isEmail function to the context of either. Here, map of isEmail receives either of integer and a string and converts that to either of integer and boolean. But why fixing only the first type parameter? Can we also fix the second type parameter to define another map function? Let's take a look at the definition of either. As we know, either is a union of left and right structures. Looking at the definition of left and right, they seem to be pretty symmetrical. Both simply wraps a single type in the same manner regardless of what we name them. That means when it comes to defining map function for either, there shouldn't be any difference between the order of type parameters. We can also fix the second type parameter to define another map function. Let's call our new map function mapLeft. So mapLeft maps the first type parameter and map function the second one. By fixing the second type parameter, mapLeft lifts to a string function to a new function that receives either of integer and a string and converts that to either of string and a string. Obviously, we need to check for functor laws to make sure we can do this, but I leave that to enthusiastic folks to check. Okay, so far so good. But you may ask, why do we need to define another map function? Can't we just map first and second type parameter at the same time? In order to do that, we definitely need two things. We need to know how to convert integer to a string for the first type parameter, and how to convert a string to boolean for the second one. We can use toString for the first and isEmail for the second type parameter. These would be the inputs to our new mapping function. Let's call this mapping function byMap. Since we could define byMap for either, we say either is bifunctor. Let's take a look at bifunctor definition. Bifunctor is a type class, meaning it knows and specifies a same behavior for a bunch of structures. Here, F represents these kind of structures. The shared behavior for bifunctor structures is that they all have bymap method. As we have just seen, the way bymap works is it first receives two general unary functions. It then receives F of A and B. And by using our input functions, it returns f of c and d. Well, this is not a valid TypeScript syntax. Let's take a look at bifunctor definition in TypeScript. As you have already know from higher-kinded types video, we can use HKT to model higher-kinded types in TypeScript. The number 2 in HKT2 represents higher-kinded types for structures of kind 2 or more. If this looks new to you, please check out my videos on higher-kinded types and type classes in this course. Alright, but just the fact that a structure wraps two types, it doesn't automatically make it bifunctor. Similar to functors, in order for a structure to be bifunctor, it needs to follow some laws. The good news is, we're already familiar with these laws. In order to see this, let's refresh what we already know about functors in category theory again. We learned that functors are simply mappings between categories. We also learned that categories consist of objects and arrows. We can think of objects as types and arrows as functions. Functor maps each object and each arrow from the first category to the second one. Let's look at objects first. Let's say we have an object A in category C. Since F is functor, it maps any object like A from category C to an object FA in category D. We already know that for structures like either that wrap two type parameters. By fixing one of the type parameters, we can define a functor for the other type parameter. For example, here I'm fixing a string as the first type parameter for either. This lets us to map, for example, integer from the first category to either of a string and integer in the second category. In other words, by fixing the first type parameter to a general type B, we can map any type A to either of B and A. As I mentioned before, for either, we don't have to fix the first type parameter. As a matter of fact, we can fix the second type parameter, and doing that doesn't make any difference in our ability to define functor instance for either. But when we are looking at either as bifunctor, we don't want to fix a single type parameter. We want our mapping to also consider B as a dynamic element. So let's move B next way. Now our mapping is from an object representing A and B to either of A and B. It seems that this mapping is from two things to one thing. As a matter of fact, our category C can be separated into two different categories. Each has one of the labels as an object. More accurately, category C is a product of two categories. And the way we define this product is for any pair of objects in initial categories, we will have an object in our product category C. Let's do the same for arrows. For each arrow coming out of any object AB, we have an arrow in category C from AB to A'B'. We can label this product arrow FG, which represents both morphisms F and G at the same time. We already know either bifunctor maps objects between categories. We can define our mapping for arrows same as what we did for functors. If there is an arrow between two objects in the initial category such as FG, there should be an arrow between the corresponding objects in the other category. We know how to create either of A and B from AB programmatically. But how can we come up with this new mapped arrow? This is exactly what bimap does for us. Bimap receives two functions F and G and returns a new function in the context of either. Do you see it? Bifunctor is exactly same as functor. We are just looking closer at our either structure and found that it is constructed of not just one thing, but two things. As a matter of fact, if we look at bifunctor laws, they are nothing but a rewrite of functor laws for two type parameters. Let's start with identity law. Identity law states that if we apply identity first and then map the objects, it should lead to the same result as if we map the identity arrows first and then apply the mapped identities. And this is the identity law for bifunctor. For the composition law, let's assume we have another arrow following the first one. The composition law states if we map our arrows first and then compose them, it should lead to the same result as if we compose the first two arrows and then map the composed arrow. And this is the composition law for bifunctor. These laws ensure that bifunctors are consistent and predictable when mapping over both type parameters simultaneously. As you see, bifunctor laws are actually functor laws extended for two type parameters. This means we can find some interesting stuff about them. For example, what happens if we pass identity as the first function to bymap? This means we don't want to change the first type parameter in either. In other words, this is same as fixing the first type parameter in our structure. This is effectively same as what map function does in either functor. And this is not specific to either, but any bifunctor f. So if we have a lambda function like this, it would be equal to our map function in functor. Let's go through a list of these interesting cases. Try to pause the video on each of them and see if you can guess what should be the other side of the equation. From what we learned today, what does it mean to pass id as the second argument to bymap? You guessed it right. This is same as mapLeft. If you have a hard time understanding this, try to draw this using dots and arrows similar to what I did for map. It should become clear. What would happen if we pass id to both of the bymap parameters? This is effectively returning a function that doesn't change neither of the structure's first or second type parameters. Or in other words, this is same as id itself. For the next one, we have a lambda function that receives two functions f and g, and composes mapLeft of f and mapLeft of g. In order to understand this, let's focus on the map and mapLeft equations on the top. Map transforms a structure's second wrap type, and mapLeft transforms the first wrap type. Composing them together gives us bymap. If this is still not clear, draw this and it should become obvious. For the next one, let's swap the order of composing mapLeft and map functions. If you think about it, this leads to the same result as the previous one, which is bymap again. What happens if we compose map of f and map of g? We've already seen this in the functor composition video. This will lead to map of f and g composed. What about composing map left? You guessed it right. It would be similar to composing map. Composing map left of f and map left of g functions is same as map left of f and g composed. And with that, thank you for watching this video. Please like and subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.